Jane, how are you?
Good, and you?
Yeah, good, thank you. Thank you so much for taking time to talk to me. I know you're away at the moment.
No problem, my pleasure.
So I'm calling you to talk about kind of autumn winter 20, in particular your kind of eco-futurist approach to design and materials, which has always been such a core part of your brand identity. And this season, I believe 50% of the collection is now labelled as regenerated, so coming entirely from upcycling and transforming existing materials. So first, I was really interested to kind of go back, and I'm interested to know more about your love of vintage and upcycling and where that first came from.
When I was going to school, I was already buying in like secondhand shop or market on the weekend. And I was dressing like that without knowing so much, actually, the reference of this garment. So it started there. And of course, my granddad was making brocante, but he was more making it for like collecting objects, really small objects that don't have so much value, like small key hangers and glasses and cups and stuff like that. But just by collecting it, he was making it, I don't know, beautiful to me. So I think it's always about, you know, how you look at things that make them, you know, becoming something else, like almost for me, luxury. So I think really the base of this love is really coming from, yeah, just like looking at things, looking at where they come from. They have an history behind just you, you know. So and it has something a little bit unknown and magical that I like in vintage. So I think everything starts there. And, you know, now when I'm doing that, I also all the time think like I'm almost like an archiver. You really go back into the past and then you just found there something interesting. So, and also the thing I really like there is that it's our own archive. So it's also human archive in the sense that it have been made and created by other people like us before. So I quite like the circling there.
When you're transitioning that into the brand and you talk about eco-futurism and the clothes as future wear, which you've always done since you founded the brand, could you kind of, for people that may not understand what that means, kind of explain to you what future wear means in the terms of Marine Serre?
The first thing that is really important, I think, to say is that, you know, nothing is magical in the sense that, you know, it's like everything is all the time evolving. So ecofuturism and future wear, they are words that have been even created after I start working like that. So it's all the time, you know, by doing and by doing again and by thinking about what you do that finally you even found a name. It's really difficult to find a name before. So most of the time it come after. I think that's really important thing. And also even right now, you know, we are keeping evolving every day. It's not like we are just doing ecofuturism and then we are just going to get stuck with what we are doing right now. So I think that's the most important thing. And it's actually quite changing if you compare to, you know, how we are used to communicating fashion. Normally you said, okay, my identity is this, my vision is that, the muse is this, and then basta. So I feel like for me, it's more like embracing the world, and the world is also changing really fast. So you have to be able to evolve with it. So first of all, then ecofuturism means that for me, like it's really kind of resilience and adaptation to the world that you are around you, and all the time trying to do it with a certain balance and respect with what the world can give back to itself. So it's almost like when you are creating, first rule will be not to harm the world around you and really to adapt. So first, I mean, it's actually already a big constraint when you think about it. It's quite difficult not to harm anyone or anything when you are creating. Then of course, second thing is the circularity. That is really a core part of the brand identity, in which there we are like regenerating, or what people call more often upcycling. We are then, you know, working on transformation. And of course, all this process is also really linked to climate neutrality, on the sense that when we are producing or when we are creating, we also are thinking about who is going to stitch, who is going to cut, where is it going to be? Do these people understand what we are doing? Do they believe in ecofuturism? So it's also really social on the way that, I mean, actually this story will not be possible if people will not have helped us on the beginning, like factory included and all the team working with us today. So it's also a lot about, yeah, like believing that you can change a system that is, you know, how it was. So it's on a way quite ambitious, but also just, it's just something about being driven by trying to create a better world, I will say. Not meaning that we will arrive, but at least we will try.
Kind of going off what you were just saying, I'd like to talk a bit about the four lines that the brand's now divided into. So we've got red, which is kind of couture, white, which I believe are building blocks of the collection, borderline underwear, and gold, which is kind of the main area of the collection. And I really pick up on that idea of kind of hybridity and transformation, especially in that area. But I'd love to know a bit more about why over time you've created the lines and maybe how they've kind of helped you develop the brand. I imagine it's brought some sort of clarity and transparency both for yourself and customer in the way that you work and design and your approach.
Yeah, exactly. So it was, you know, like when you arrive in the kind of fashion business and then you realize that people are expecting a lot and extremely fast. And if you are not really sharp about what you show, it's sometimes getting out of control. Like, you know, like you feel like people don't really understand the same thing that you would like to them to understand. And then also when you start selling, then you have of course the retailer approach that is really strong, because on the way it's them that is making your business survive. Certainly for us at the beginning, we do not add a really strong web platform, so we were extremely dependent. And I think when I jump into that, because it was of course quite, you know, it went really fast, I was thinking just it was so important to clarify also and like, for example, if I will not have done the line, I will never have keep doing red line garments or couture or red carpet garments, because we don't sell them. So like, you know, if it's almost like I try to put on a paper what was the four most important thing, but what was also the purpose of this garment at the end, because otherwise you will always do the one that, you know, that people is going to, that they are going to dress. And then you will forget about, for example, yeah, I don't know, a bra, or you will forget about a couture dress, because that's not, yeah, that's not what people are going to buy, a 20,000 euro dress. So it was a kind of guideline exercise. And also I think as the brand was growing, it was good. Then I could communicate better with my team and with the manufacturer and also with the retailer to explain them all these different process. And then I think another thing is, for example, if you compare the gold line and the white line, we develop a lot of new process in the gold and in the red, certainly with upcycling, regenerating, transforming. But we were really expensive. So because it just costs a time to, you know, to transform a carpet into a dress or a skirt, for example. So, and there I had really something like a drive that was really important, I think, for me and for us. It was that I really want regenerated to go in the street, because, you know, even me, I could not afford one of the skirts that I created. So I thought, okay, that don't make so much sense with with what I want to say. So I have to find a way. And that is really, really a hard exercise, because, yeah, just the fact that we are transforming costs so much time. So meaning that if we want to make white line garments that are a bit more affordable, but keep the authenticity of transforming them, it means that the design have to change. The amount of action in that we are going to do to build a garment have to change. And of course, that's really something that I'm really interested on, because I think it's really important today. And basically, this is what we are mainly actually working on right now, because the gold and the red and the borderline are quite, like, are starting to be quite developed. But the white, yeah, it's the most challenging, I would say. And this is more like a kind of, yeah, like daily garderobe, you know, like simple jeans, simple daily, yeah, jeans jacket or an upcycled dress t-shirt or, you know, things like that.
I'd like to talk a bit more about those regenerated fabrics. This season we had six in particular. So we had silk scarves, faux fur, pillowcases, denim and knit, and the carpet, which I'm really obsessed with. So Autumn 20 called Mind Melange Motor, and all about this idea of kind of humans being on different planets and this kind of advanced mindset and being able to travel with this kind of magic thing called melange in between them. I'd love to know from you, if you could tell me a bit more about the narrative and how that informed those fabric choices.
But actually, the funny thing is that everything starts from the fabric and not the other way around. So every season, the first thing I'm doing is searching with my team on what are going to be the new fabric. So the story always come after. So it's not the other way around. And that I also really like, because I feel it's a bit more... Yeah, it's actually a bit more resilient on the way that you can only create with what you are going to find. Mm-hmm. And then the story is going to be built around that. And of course, the magic is to be able to, you know, to pick some of the things that you are going to find and make sense with that. And I think, yeah, this is quite a melange on the way. And also to be able to mix, because as we have, as you said on the beginning of the talk, we have 50% that are regenerated and the other 50% that are artisanally made, making from recycled thread, etc. So it's also really important to understand that each collection starts from the regenerated, actually, and like the artisanal tailoring wool or things like that, they will be on the way built around what have been found for the regenerated pieces, to make, like, yeah, in themselves, like, you know, this carpet, it's impossible to make them again. They are like brocart. I mean, it's so just beautiful in itself. So, you know, even us, when we are working with that, we try to make as less action as possible, you know, and to place it almost like flat on the garment, but still should make sense. But it's also really about, yeah, like it's a special way to drape or to design, because you have to start from the material. And on that sense, you know, on the creative process in the brand, we are really like, we just drape, and then only after we go to pattern.
So I was watching this season's regenerated series of films, and you can really see that incredible transformation that these fabrics go through, kind of, you know, the denim with the bleaching, and the kind of, I love that it's up close with everyone's hands working on it, and you can really see that kind of metamorphosis as it kind of transforms into that kind of Marine Serre universe, which I think is just really great.
This video, they were, you know, like on the beginning, we just did it like that because we just like to show how we were working. But I think they are also becoming more and more important for us, but also for like the people that are dressing us. It just, you can see the time indeed, and the care and the transformation, and in how much hand is passing. And already, you know, this material, they have an history, and then on top of that, they are indeed like being transformed. So yeah, I just think that on the way, you know, it's what I like with this video is that you can understand it without word. And I think that was always a little bit a goal for me in fashion, because, you know, people are all the time wanting to talk a lot, and I'm not really a really good talker. So I was just, you know, I just thinking, yeah, the best way is just to show, because at the end, you know, fashion is really about making. And I think what is really, yeah, driving me there is to see really the end and the savoir-faire and the time that all these people pass in the garment. So yeah.
I'd also like to talk a bit about how regeneration feeds into the rest of the collection, kind of upcycled threads that you use throughout the rest of the collection that aren't labelled as entirely regenerated.
Actually, we have much more success with regenerated garments and regenerated just video, we see since March a lot of people like asking questions and being really curious. So it's really, really nice. You have some of the material that you cannot find in regenerated. For example, jersey, you know, something that you have really close of your skin, like the moon top. It's really difficult to find good quality in regenerated or like second hand. It's almost not existing. That's also why it was really important for me to create Borderline. And there, for example, the moon top is made from a fully recycled thread. Same for the cotton that we use for the underwear. And this was just important. And this is also why I call it underwear, because it's not meant to be on top. It's just meant to be under your pullover, under your pants. And it's a kind of styling piece, but it's just like a kind of protective part for Borderline. And of course, it's really important for us to you know, to use good fabric, good way of printing, and to just be aware of what we are doing. And yeah, and I mean, the other part is also just because, of course, we are really trying for the wide line to offer, you know, for example, with the jeans jacket and the jeans pants that you were talking about, a kind of a carryover of regenerated garment that people can find in the brand. Because of course, as we were changing every season of upcycled material, it was sometime, you know, almost too short to buy a pants, and then you will never have it. So we are also trying to, yeah, to find a way to make it more affordable. And then after, for example, we had, it's just quite simple. Is every time that we could not find it in regenerated, we develop it with recycled thread. For example, the tailoring. It's also really difficult to find, you know, or to work with tailoring, because the state of the wool is not always really good. And also the hand, because when you make a coat, you need something that folds in a proper way. And of course, we are in contact with amazing jacquard wool factory in Italy that are able really in an artisanal way to work with us on this. So it's also important for me and for us to support this artisanal, because at the end, what we are using from regenerating piece most of the time is actually from artisanal that do not exist anymore. For example, if I would like to reproduce the carpet, it's impossible today. So, you know, it's also important, I think, to support, because one day we will not have anything to regenerate, maybe. So, you know, it's just like just being conscious about the world around us and what we cannot use from regenerated, we are creating it in a careful way with artisans that are really having an amazing knowledge and that we want to support them.
I think that I really love that aspect of the brand, and I want to kind of touch on that more, and just I'm interested because I mean the brand's grown so incredibly quickly in the last couple of years, which is amazing and so exciting. And there's this essential nature to it of everything we've been talking about, working with regenerated fabrics and with artisans, but taking that into account, I want to touch on what you said about kind of finding this new pace of working and how you found growing yourself as a business in this kind of mad world of fashion, which moves way too fast and produces way too much, and how you found the process of establishing yourself as a brand and resisting that, and how you kind of plan to grow in the future and what your kind of goal is.
Just by working, by continuing, by regenerating garment, it's really heavy. Like clearly, it's a huge challenge. Production is a really difficult process, because we have not more time than other brand. We kind of have to deliver at the same time on the sense, because otherwise, no one is going to buy it if it's delivered 2 years later. So you still have a timing to kind of respect. Of course, now things are quite changing with everything that is happening around us. So the web store is working differently, and To be honest, I think it's really, on the way, I have the chance that it's my brand. So if I'm not, you know, if I cannot look at myself in the morning when I look at myself in the mirror, I will not be able to do it. So it's kind of a rule, like, you know, the most important thing at the end is to love and care about what you do. And I think the brand really start there. So it's meaning that you have really clear limits on what you don't want to do. And I think the most important thing also is that the brand is not driven by making money. The goal is not that. The goal is to create really better way of producing, a better way of creating. But everything, every step is so important, even the way we are designing or the way we are collecting. And I think, yeah, you can really feel it also in the team spirits. I mean, I can say that I think like everyone that is working with me is really driven by the story of the brand. And of course, we are really far from being perfect. And sometimes also we are having too much to do and things are going fast. But then we all the time like think and then. You know, and then we are thinking, okay, yeah, that's too fast and there we need to change, or that is too complex for now, we are not managing to do. So it's also about being honest and not all the time wanting too much, because I think that's something that fashion is really good with, certainly for making you feel that you should do something. So it's kind of, actually, we said a lot of time, we said no, I must say. That's kind of... that's kind of recurrent. Maybe one day would change a bit, but yeah, so for now it's quite about that and keeping really radical about what we don't want to do. Yeah, and not thinking we are perfect, and we are learning every day. We are a team of really young people, but at least I think we have the same drive or dream to want to change something in the way of producing, in the way of working. And I think we are at the end really proud of what we do.
Well, I think that's a lovely place to finish. Thank you so much for taking the time to talk to me, Marine. It's been so interesting to hear more about the brand.
No, thank you. Really, really happy that we could chat. See you soon.
Bye.
Ciao.